السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره. ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فهو المهتدي ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. وأشهد أن سيدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. صلى الله على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. Dear brothers and sisters, our topic is still the life of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Those companions, may Allah blessing bestowed on them, are made under the supervision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself raised them up, connected them together with the bonds of love, compassion, and friendship. We see this in the ayah, وَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِهِمْ, united their hearts. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. لو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا ما ألفت بين قلوبهم. So they are beyond being the students of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They've been under the supervision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لو أنفقت ما في الأرض جميعا ما ألفت بين قلوبهم ولكن الله ألف بينهم. It is God who made them love each other and care about each other. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is showing his mercy and blessing and bounty on them. إِذْ كُنْتُمْ أَعْدَاءً فَأَلَّفَ بَيْنَ قُلُوبِكُمْ فَأَصْبَحْتُمْ بِنِعْمَتِهِ إِخْوَانًا. So the Sahaba al-Kiram were raised by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and made what they are by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the praise for them came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he said, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was addressing the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam al-Qurtubi, in his tafsir, al-Jami' li-Ahkam al-Qur'an, said that Ibn Abbas, in this interpretation of this ayah, said, those who migrated from Mecca to Medina and attended Badr and attended Hudaybiyah. كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةِ, those are the best generation. They've been described by many, many of the ayahs of being great, loving, caring, merciful, compassionate. مُحَمَّدٌ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ مَعَهُ أَشِدَّاءُ عَلَى الْكُفَّارِ رُحَمَاءُ بَيْنَهُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased with them. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُبَايِعُونَكَ إنما يبايعون الله يد الله فوق أيديهم. Allah's hand is above their hands. In the same surah, لقد رضي الله عن المؤمنين إذ يبايعونك تحت الشجرة فعلم ما في قلوبهم. Who are those believers? Those who were pledging to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam the support under the tree. Bay'atul Rudwan. Why we call it Bay'atul Rudwan? Because Allah is pleased with them. لقد رضي الله. رضي is in the past sentence. It's a done deal. It's sealed. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is above and beyond the time and the days. For him, he sees things outside the time. He knows them now, tomorrow, and after tomorrow. And he knew the Sahaba al-Kiram, what they are and what they will be. And he was pleased with them. We are re-emphasizing these facts, for anyone who is misguided or he's ignorant, or he inherited some package from his culture or upbringing to certain parents, to re-examine this issue. If there is anything touches the companion of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in any negative way, it's a very serious matter. From all these ayat and these coming ayat, والسابقون الأولون من المهاجرين والأنصار, those are the companions, العشر المبشرين and المهاجرين and الأنصار and أبو بكر and عمر and Uthman, and Ali, and Aisha, and Talha, and Az-Zubayr. Those are included in this ayah. وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. It's done deal. It's the contract has been sealed till the day of judgment. So be careful if you have any other ideas or opinions. You might hurt yourself big time. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told us, khayrul quruni qarni. The best of the generation is my generation. Who are his generation? The companions. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in this strong wording hadith narrated by Imam al-Tirmidhi, warning us not to target the companions with any criticism. Allah, Allah fi ashabi, la tattakhidhuhum gharadan min ba'di. Faman ahabbahum fa bihubbi ahabbahum. Anyone who loves them, this is a sign he loves me. وَمَنْ أَبْغَضَهُمْ فَبِبُغْضِي أَبْغَضَهُمْ. And you, anyone who hates a companion, it carry with it hidden hatred to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to Islam, and to Quran, and to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ آذَاهُمْ فَقَدْ آذَانِي. Anyone who hurt them, or bad mouth them, it will hurt me. وَمَنْ آذَانِي فَقَدْ آذَى اللَّهِ. And anyone who try to hurt me, he is hurting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is offending Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَنْ آذَى اللَّهِ شَكَ أَنْ يَأْخُذَ. And anyone who try to offend God, God will take care of him. That's why the Muslim Ummah for all these generations have nothing but the praise to the companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And always we follow their names by the statement radiyallahu an. May God be pleased with him. And we hold them all for many, many reasons we have mentioned before. And on the top of it, they have been the friends of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You as a Christian, who are the best? They said the friend of Isa alayhi salam, Jesus, the 12. You as the Jews, who are the best among you? They said the 70 who were around Musa alayhi salam. And we the Muslims, we say the best are those companions who were around the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And anyone who says otherwise, he have a malice and hatred and grudge and illness in his heart, and he need to take care of it before it's too late. The Muslim Ummah attitude about all the prophets and all the great people of history. تِلْكَ أُمَّةٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ لَهَا مَا كَسَبَتْ وَلَكُمْ مَا كَسَبْتُمْ وَلَا تُسْأَلُونَ عَمَّا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. And we know this ayah has been repeated twice in a short distance in Surah Al-Baqarah. And it was on behalf of the prophets that they have earned their position with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And they are going to be accountable, responsible for their action. تلك أمة قد خلت لها ما كسبت. So mind your business and mind what you're doing in this life of yours, because you are accountable and responsible for your time which you are wasting in nonsense, with your shortcoming about yourself and your family and your society and your whole ummah. You are responsible for what you're doing. Be busy what you're doing. Don't sit down and start bad-mouthing people of history, yesterday generations. Every generation has their own problems and headaches and challenges and their achievement. And when they die, their books of record has been sealed. It's not our business. تلك أمة قد خلت لها ما كسبت ولكم ما كسبتم. Let's look at our situation and try to solve our problems. We have a lot of problems on hand. Start from our health, which is in the bottom. Our medical care, it's in the bottom. Our bad habits like smoking and drinking and gambling and all the ills of society, it's very high among Muslims. The poverty is all over. The income of a Muslim probably $1 a day. Be busy with yourself, improve on yourself. Leave the Sahaba al-Kiram alone. They have done what's supposed to do, and they are gone, and Allah is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Allah. Why we're emphasizing this? Because this issue is continuing, and I know my words not gonna change anything, and it's costing the Muslim Ummah tons of money, efforts, lives, and wars, and killing. And it has to come to a stop. Otherwise, everyone will perish as a fool, as Martin Luther King said. Let's mind our current situation. Let's mind our generation. Let's mind our children, how they are raised up, and look for their future. Look at the Muslim children all over. It hurts me so much. You find the children in other cultures, societies, religions, and so on, countries. You find the health coming out of their bodies. You find them enjoying life. You find them doing all kind of sports, scouting, everything, gardens, schools. And you look at the Muslim children, at the garbage dumpsters and so on all over the world, without parents, being killed with bombs and terrorists and so on. Let's be busy with our situation and our conditions and try to improve on it. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, when he was asked about things happened, historic things, we know Islam has been sealed with the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. with Hijjat al-Wada, when the ayah came, Al-Yawma atmamtu lakum dinakum wa atmamtu alaykum ni'mati wa raditu lakum al-Islam deena. So what happened, and most of what we have of problems is history. Has nothing to do with Islam. We know what's Islam. It's in the Quran and the Sunnah. History is something we need to overcome. We mentioned many times, look at other religions. Look at Jews and Christians. They are at odds with in relation to Jesus, peace be upon him. They reconcile their problems and they are working together and they are producing a lot of good for themselves first and for everyone else. Look at the nationality in Europe. They have 1,000 years of wars. They realize in this age of time, 21st century, they cannot survive or live like this. They came together and they became one body, one entity. This is the age where groups and conglomerate of things together to can survive, otherwise you will sink. Even here in medicine, if you don't belong to a big group, 80, 90 doctors or 100 or 200 to bargain with the insurance company, if you are on your own, you're drowning. You're out of business. So for Muslims, we look at the whole humanity as a family. We need to be as a human species, caring about each other and trying to solve the challenges of depletion of the energy sources and the pollution and the ozone and the forest acid rain and all of this. We have to put all our hands together to solve these problems. For us believers in God and the oneness of God, like Christian and Jews and Muslims, they have to put their hands, because their enemy is not each other. Their enemy is those who deny God and the people who trying to make fun of the prophets and the religions. We have to put our hands together, because we know our religions ask us to be charitable and alleviate human suffering. And that's what the Quran said 1,400 years ago to the Muslims, to the Jews and the Christian. Let's work together and compete in doing good to alleviate human suffering. And of course, it's very obvious, Muslims together, whatever madhahib or sects or all of them, they have to come together to help each other, to help improve on their situations. And this is what the Quran order us. This is what Islam entice us to do good. This is kuntum khayra ummah. For what? Ta'muruna bil ma'roof, to enjoin good. وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ and forbid evil. وَتُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ and believe in God. So Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, when he was asked about some of the historic things happened among the companions and about the succession issue and so on, and Ahmad ibn Hanbal, as you know, came in the second or third century, he said, those are historic events, bloodshed events and situations happened far behind me, and I wasn't part of it. I didn't participate in it, so I will hold my tongue off of talking about it. And he attributed all of this to ijtihad, and not every ijtihad is right. If you are right, you are rewarded twice. If you are wrong, you are rewarded once. And in his opinion, and you know his opinion is the opinion of his madhab, that anyone who badmouths any of the companions, he would not see he's a Muslim. مَا أَرَاهُ عَلَى الْإِسْلَامِ. So the same thing, all the imams, Abu Hanifa and Ahmad and Imam Malik and Imam Shafi'i, they have all the praise to all the companions. They don't badmouth or criticize any one of them at all. just for the simple reason they are companions of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For the simple reason their gaze been set on the figure of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I hope we will follow, pursue, and educate our friends who now and then they try to bring some issues related to them. And our companion for today is Huzaifa ibn Al Yaman Al Absi. Huzaifa ibn Al Yaman, may Allah be pleased with him, radiallahu anhu. Very interesting personality. His father name is Husayl ibn Jabir. And Yaman is a title which means originally he is from Yemen. Husayl ibn Jabir is from Mecca or around Mecca. He is from Bani Abs. And in the Jahiliyyah, he had some blood problems, blood feud, and he escaped to Medina. That time was Yathrib, and he lived among them, and he had alliance with Bani Abd al-Ashhal, and he married from them, and he had two sons, Safwan ibn Yaman, and Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman. Then his predicament and the issue of the blood was settled, and he was able to go back to Mecca. So he lived between Mecca and Yathrib in the Jahiliyyah. And the same thing with his son. He used to move with his dad back and forth. And they became Muslim very early, Husayl, his father, and Safwan, his brother, and Huzaifa came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Mecca and accepted Islam. And that was after the Hijrah. And he was given the choice to be Muhajir or Ansari. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam told them, you have the choice to pledge on the way of the Muhajirin or of the Ansar. So you choose what's closest to your heart. So Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman asked the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to be accepted the Islam on the way of the Ansar, Bay'at al-Ansar. So we consider him from Al-Ansar. Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman had a long history, like all the companions, in the life of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and after the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He lived 25 years after the death of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he died in the year 36 of the Hijrah. He died in a city or a village called Al-Madain. It is in Iraq, northern Iraq. And his tomb or his grave is next to a masjid there, the only masjid in the city or in the village, called Masjid Salman Al-Farisi. A chamber next to the masjid has two graves. One of them is the grave of Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman. The second grave is the grave of Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. The reference I'm taking this information from mentioned that he met the imam of that masjid. Currently, these are in the last century, like 50 years ago. And he told him the story of the grave of Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman. He told him that it was closer to the river, the Tigris River, and with the factor of erosion, there was some danger on the grave to be disintegrated and exposed. So with an order of King Faisal I, this is the son of Al-Sharif Hussein, the one who led the revolt against the Ottoman, and was his son Faisal I, assigned to be the king of Iraq. That was in the 20s of the 20th century. So King Faisal ordered the grave to be moved up higher ground next to the Masjid of Salman. And according to that book, that when they dug the grave, they found the body of Huzaifa Ibn Al Yaman intact. And he's been carried to the new location. Huzaifa Ibn Al Yaman had many certificates, we need to know them, many achievements, and many badges of honor, we need to know them. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma haddathakum Huzaifa fasaddiqu." So he received a certificate of honesty and telling the truth. Of course, all the companions tell the truth, but when you have, you know, like all of them know how to read Quran, but when they emphasize, وَمَا أَقْرَأَكُمْ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ بِنْ مَسْعُودِ فَقْرَأُوا. So the way Abdullah ibn Mas'ud recite the Quran, you recite like him. So this is one of the honor badges on the chest of Al-Yaman. So Huzaifa ibn Al-Yaman, when he became Muslim, and he was very eager, he was Muslim as a youth, you know, with his father and mother and his brother. And they decided to make final migration to Yathrib, to Medina, and to live there. And it happened at the time of the Battle of Badr. And he is telling us what happened, because his intention was to go there and be like the shadow of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is, as we mentioned last week, in Arabic we say lazama rasulillah. So it means he became stuck to him. You know, lazama inna adabaha kana gharama, it's luzum, which means he's always there with him. So at that time, Quraysh were preparing for a war, and they have spies everywhere and so on. So they caught Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman and his father, Husayl ibn Jabir, on the way from Mecca to Medina. So they captured them and asked them, "Where are you going to?" They told them, "We're going to Medina, to our home." They said, "No, you are going to fight with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." And they said, "No, we are going back home." And then they told him, "We'll let you go free if you give us your word you are not going to fight with Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam." They said, "That's fine." So they gave him their word. And when they arrived to Yathrib, they went right away to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him what happened. Here the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Nafi bi'ahdihim wa nasta'inu alayhim billah." Told Huzaifa and his father, "Fulfill your promise not to fight with me, and we ask help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." So you see how it's important to fulfill your promise, to honor your word, not to break your vow, to honor the contract you're signing. It's very sacred in Islam, uncompromised with the Muslim and with everyone. This amana, it cross board, honesty, cross board, like taking care of parents. You don't have to be a Muslim to take care of your parents. it's all over, you have to take care of your parents. And imagine a battle going on the sideline, somebody sitting and like the people who attend football or something, and he's cheering, you know, this part, or the, you know, they're cheering the Muslims, yes, go, you know, and they are sitting on the line. Beautiful scenery. In Uhud, and we know that Huzaifa ibn al Yaman became like the shadow of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ever since, till he died. Never let him in any occasion, any expedition, anything. So in Uhud, Huzaifa was there, and his father was there. And his father was an old man then. And he was assigned with another old man, old companion, with the name of Thabit ibn Waqash, to guard the women in their places. So the order for them was to not to fight. You just stay on the side and, you know, like guards. But when the battle was so hot and the Muslims were defeated and so on, they were enticed to go and fight, and they did. And the first one was killed, and Husayl ibn Jabir, the father of Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, was killed also in the battle, but unfortunately, he was killed by a friendly fire. The Muslim did not know who is he, and during the battle, they thought he is one from Quraysh, and he was killed by Muslims. And Huzaifa would call, "It's my father," but it's a war, you know, and so noisy and nobody would hear, and he fell, but he's a martyred. And Huzaifa did not cuss everyone nor say bad things. He said, "Yaghfiru Allahu lakum wa huwa arhamar rahimin." May Allah forgive you to those who killed him, and Allah is merciful. And when the news came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that the father of Huzaifa was killed by the Muslims, he wanted to pay the diya, the money compensation. But Huzaifa refused and told him he was asking for the shahada, and he was given to it, and I would give this diya as a charity to the Muslims. So he distributed the money for the Muslim needy. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam really had very high regard for Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman. He discovered in him three qualities. The first one, he's very smart. And the second one, he has very quick response in emergency situation with the right decision, intuition. And he has farasa, where he knows the good from the bad and the person who might hurt or so from one look. Also, he had the property of holding secrets. So unfortunately, nowadays you barely find somebody, you whisper to him something and you find after 5 minutes, everyone knows about what you said. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam tapped on these qualities. For example, for him being so sharp and holding secrets, he trusted him with the names of the hypocrites in the Medina. So Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman keep an eye on them and their gathering and trying to collect information if they are conspiring to hurt the Muslims. So he used to be known as a sahib sir Rasulillah. So he is the holder of the secrets of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam about this. And that continued till the time of Umar ibn al-Khattab. Umar ibn al-Khattab, whenever there is a janaza, he would watch. If Huzaifa is not there, he knows that this is a hypocrite, so he would not show up. So when he sees Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman there, he would go and participate in the janazah. As a matter of fact, one time he asked him, "Is in my administration anyone who is a hypocrite?" He told him one. He told him, tell me his name, but he refused. But Umar figured out who that should be, and he fired him. The second quality which the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used is his courage and smartness and quick response is in the battle of Al-Khandaq. As you know, the battle of the Khandaq, all the whole world collapsed on Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his followers, which numbered in hundreds. You know, the women and children, they are harmless, they are in their homes. But those who participated from the Muslim side, who eventually stayed, because all the hypocrites started sneaking out one by another, saying, "Inna buyutana awra," that our homes are not protected and we have women there and so on, so we want to go back home. So they start sneaking out, and Huzaifa ibn Al Yaman is telling us, we have been left, the Muslim, 300. 300 against what? 10, 30,000 of Meccan, 10,000 maybe. Ghatafan and the Bedouin and the tribes of Medina and the hypocrites and Quraysh, and the whole world collapsed on Muhammad. For what? What did he do to them? He said, La ilaha illallah, I worship God. And be good to your parents and be honest and be fair and be just. Amazing. I mean, this needs analysis to see why all the whole world collapsed over Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the battle of Khandaq. As a matter of fact, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam has said that رَمَتْكُمْ الْعَرَبُ عَنْ قَوْسٍ وَاحِدًا. The whole Arabia never been together that way. And they amassed all this power they have, and they focus it on us. You know, it's like one arrow. All their efforts, like a vector in mathematics, or we call it the vector. So all of it, رَمَتْكُمْ الْعَرَبُ عَنْ قَوْسٍ وَاحِدًا. And in another statement, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَيْحَ قُرَيْشِ قَدْ أَكَلَتْهُمِ الْحَرْبِ. They've been eaten up by the desire for war and to kill. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam offered all kind of compromises, but they would not agree. So in the battle of Al-Khandaq, the trench, we know that it was very hard. It was very hard even for the Muslims. They started questioning. And we see a beautiful description in the Quran for the battle of Al-Ahzab, Khandaq. And the weather was very harsh, tornadoes and dust and cold weather. And the Muslim been bugged onto the earth. I mean, they would not have courage to go to the bathroom or to go to the meadows or wherever to let this been described by many of the Sahaba and so on. At that time, it was obvious there will be no war, and one who first blink, he's a loser. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam realized that, and Abu Sufyan realized that. He was a leader of, before he became Muslim. And in that night, decisive night, where everyone's scared to death, they wouldn't have courage to go out or do anything. They were frozen in place. We find the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam walking among the companions, and he was close to Huzaifa and told him, who is this? He said, Huzaifa. And Huzaifa is telling us he's a human being. Himself, he shrank in his place, like, so the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will pass him, or. And because he was so hungry and so cold, and here the Prophet ordered him, Huzaifa. He said, Naam, Ya Rasulullah, O Prophet of Allah. He told him, you go there to the camp of Quraysh, and listen to what they are planning, and do not do anything other than that. And here, Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman is describing himself, how scared he was, how hungry he was, how cold he was. But when he stood up, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed for him and told Allah, he said, Allahumma ihfadh min bayni yadayhi, ihfadhu min bayni yadayhi, wa min khalfihi, wa an yaminihi, wa an shimalihi, wa min fawqihi, wa min tahtihi. And Huzaifa is telling us, فوالله ما تمت دعوة النبي عليه حتى انتزع الله من جوفي كل ما أودعه من خوف وأزال عن جسدي كل ما أصابه من برد. The minute he finished the dua, I found myself energized, felt no hunger and felt no fear and felt no cold. And he rushed to the other camp. He sneaked into the other camp and got very close to Abu Sufyan. And there, Abu Sufyan, with his also smartness, he said, oh, Quraysh, I want to tell you something, but everyone make sure we have no intruders, or and hold the hands of each other and ask about each other. It was dark and night and so on. So with the quick response of Huzaifa, he immediately took the initiative and asked the one next to him, who are you? So, you know, so he became out of suspicion, you know, with raising his voice and so on. So nobody asked him, who are you? And here Abu Sufyan said, oh, Quraysh, you see the situation, it's intolerable, the wind, the cold, and so on. I am going back. So here Huzaifa said, I swear I could have killed Abu Sufyan because he was so close to him with one single arrow. But he knew he was obeying Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he told him, do not take any action from your own. Just listen to what they're saying and come back. So he came back and he found the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam praying. And this is something we need to pay attention. Whenever there is crisis, difficult situation, dire situations, you have none but your Creator to seek refuge in Him. So you make more prayers. And this is what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was doing. He was praying to God for help. And when I arrived, he asked me, what's the news? He told him that they are leaving. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was very happy with that, and he knew that they won. And he made a statement that Quraysh will never invade us again, because this is the most they can do. And they failed. Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, after the death of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, been used by the Khulafa. And we have a couple of incidents with Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu. You know, Umar ibn al-Khattab is a giant by himself, and we need a whole course to talk about him and his seerah, his biography. One day he was in Majlis Shura, where he's running the government, and with the companions around him. And he asked him, have a wish. So several of the companions, they said, we wish we have all kind of money and gold and so on, so we would spend it for the sake of Allah. Umar ibn al-Khattab said, I have a different wish. I wish that I have people filling this space like Abu Ubaidah, Amir ibn Jarrah, and Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman. So I would use them to run the administration fi ta'atillahi azza wa jal. And he wanted to prove his point, and he told one of them, take this money to Abu Ubaidah, Amir ibn Jarrah. and see what he would do with it. He gave him the money and went to Abu Ubaidah, gave him the money. Abu Ubaidah instantly divided the money into smaller portion and distributed to the poor. And he left no penny for himself. This is the utmost of selflessness. This is a characteristic of all the Sahaba. They are selfless. They sacrificed everything they have, their lives, their money, their bodies, everything had been used for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the man came and he told him, this is another purse of money, take it to Huzaifa ibn Al Yaman and see what he would do with it. So he took the money to Huzaifa and told, this is from Umar ibn Khattab as a gift to you. So he immediately took the money, divided them into smaller portions, and distributed them to the poor and the needy of the Medina. And he left no penny for himself. He came back, and Umar ibn Khattab, expectations were right, and he told the companions, I told you, this is the quality of those people. Muhammad ibn Sirin, he's a tabi'i, we talked about him before. He is telling us this story. And he met the companions and he knows them. He said that Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, when he was a khalifa, and he would appoint a mayor or any worker for the administration, he would send a book with him telling the people or the village or the city elders with the mission of this emir. He would tell them, I'm doing this and so on, obey him and so on, and do this and that. So he appointed Huzaifa ibn al Yaman to be a mayor on Al Madain. So, and with him this book, who he gave it to the elders of the city. And in that book, Umar ibn al Khattab ordering them to listen and obey Huzaifa and to give him whatever he asks you of monetary or accommodation. So when he came there and he was received by the elders, and they asked him, ask us what you want or what you wish. He told them, and he's a mayor now, I ask you nothing but enough food for myself and for my donkey. I ask you for food for me to eat and food for my donkey to eat. That was his request. This is his stipend and salary and pension plan and severance package and everything. You know, just food every day, whatever it is, half a bread and for his donkey to eat. And he ran the city very fairly and justice. Everyone was happy. Umar ibn Khattab also, he has a check and balance. He never, though he is 100% sure of their honesty and so on, but it's probably for us who is coming later on to see what how things are, he would do check and balance. He did this with every employee he would use. We have seen it with Umayr ibn Sa'd, we have seen it with Sa'id ibn Amir, we have seen it with Khalid ibn al-Walid, though he's his cousin, and you know Khalid, who is he? When he came back, he checked him out, checked all his money, checked his home. He made sure he doesn't have any single penny outside his salary. Or we need to see this. Our the world, who is corrupted so much, they need to listen to those stories. So here he summoned Huzaifa, because things so quiet and so peaceful, he start itching, you know. So he summoned Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman to Medina. And Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anhu, he knows the way from Madain to Medina. He went outside and had an ambush for Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman to check him out like one day or 2 days before he arrived to the Medina to see for sure if he has any luggage, anything which might be, you know, bypassing the Medina or going directly to his home. Nowadays we see with those tyrants and dictators, planes loaded with luggage going somewhere east and west with money and gold and stolen things. So he ambushed Huzaifa, and he saw him the same situation. He knew him for years and years, has nothing. So when he appeared to him and saw him in this situation, he hugged him and told him, "You are my brother and I am your brother. أنت أخي وأنا أخوك." So Huzaifa ibn Al Yaman is one of the leaders who participated in getting rid of the tyrants of in Persia and Armenia and Russia. You know, he reached Russia, which nowadays the Chechen and all these areas, where became Muslim with Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman efforts. And he participated in the Battle of Nahawand. This is 150,000 of the Persian army, 150,000. And the Muslims' army was led by Al-Nu'man ibn al-Muqarrin, 30,000. And Al-Nu'man was killed, and Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman took the leadership, and the Muslims won that battle, which was very decisive. And there we know that Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman wanted to marry non-Muslims from the people of this. And Umar ibn al-Khattab was irate. And he asked him, am I doing haram thing? He said, "No, you're not doing haram, but who's going to marry the Muslims' woman if you are going to marry?" You know, because Muslim women cannot marry but Muslims, you know. So, and he is credited with one of the important things which happened in the time of Uthman ibn Affan. As you know, Islam spread was astonishing speed of light. And Muslims were so much diluted in no time. And you have a lot of Arab and ignorant people and so on. So in a way, Islam fell a victim to its own success. We find many people don't speak Arabic, and they started reading Quran right and left. And here, Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman was alarmed about this problem, which has to do with the language and with the punctuation and with many other issues. It's not the society of Medina anymore. Not the eloquent Arabic speakers of Quraysh. It's now from China to North Africa to the whole wide area. So he came to Uthman ibn Affan, he was a Khalifa, and brought his attention to this problem, which can divide the Muslims, and everyone has his own Quran and his own reading. And we know that Uthman ibn Affan, radiallahu not canonized, but standardized the book and made copy of five or some narration, six copies. And those copies became al-mushaf al-um, the text or the reference for every society or every country in the Muslim world, like Sham, Masr, Iraq, and so on. And he kept one in the Medina. And he saved the Muslims of disagreeing on the Quran, and he get this credit. And Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman, radiallahu anh, when he became sick and he knew that he is dying, it was close to the dawn, and he asked the people around him what time we are. He said, "It is the morning." And he said, "A'udhu billahi min sabahin yufdi bi ila an-nar." I seek refuge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from this morning if I die and I find myself in hellfire. I mean, Huzaifa ibn al-Yaman fearing hellfire. How about us? I mean, so, and they brought him very expensive shroud to be like kafan, to be wrapped in it. But he said, "Why is that? I mean, it's expensive and it's useless. I mean, senseless to use it. So get me some simple kafan, which I, because I know when I'm buried, if I am saved and going to heaven, immediately I will be replaced with different clothes. If I am going to hell, you know, my clothes will be worse. So no reason to use this expensive shroud. And when he died, he made a statement that this is a time, if you regret your shortcoming, it's not going to help you. So we need to take care of ourselves and take care of our lives, take care of our ibadat, take care not to be in debt to anyone, and to be careful not to grudge or have infringe on others' rights. Be the one who somebody infringe on you, and do not be the one who infringes on others. So, because in the Day of Judgment, nothing will help. Whatever you are looking for this dunya, it's gonna be gone. So try to balance your sheet at the end of the day. If it's zero, you're lucky. If it's positive, you are even better lucky. But do not be under. Do not have sayyat on your records every day. So this is a story of Huzaifa ibn Al Yaman radiallahu an. Inshallah, next week we will talk about another sahabi. Aqulu qawli hadha wa astaghfirullah al-azim li wa lakum, wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.